so many faces and that the ice didn't scare any of you away. I'll try to be brief and I'll try not to be too emotional. The Lord gave me a lot this week. You know, the Bible says that Jesus only said what his Father said and did what his Father did. It also says that speak to things that are not as though they are. The only things that are not are to our human, to our physical eye. I believe when Jesus spoke and did the things he did, it wasn't because he couldn't see or that it was not, because it was. Does that make sense? And so I've been praying for a while for the Lord to open my eyes so that I could see like he sees. And for this past week, if you were to look in the human eye from the physical perspective, been a week from hell. But from the spiritual perspective, I've had the most unbelievable spiritual week I've ever experienced. And I'm going to try to share a little bit of it with you. A week ago Saturday, coming home from work, in a hurry to get home. Dan wasn't feeling well. I just wanted to get something for dinner and get home. And as I get out of my car, a lady stopped in the parking lot. She was walking with a cane, unkept. The average person probably would have shied away. And she said, "Excuse me," she said, could I hold your hand or hold your arm and walk me in?" She said, "The wind is so windy." She said, "I just want someone to steady me." And I said, "Absolutely." And so I just went over and hugged up to her, grabbed her arm and, you know, got all snuggly with her and walked as slow as she needed to walk and walked her in. Not to pat myself on the back or anything like that. These are just God things I want to share with you. She unloaded a little bit, you know, how she was feeling, things going on in her life, and I just conversed with her. And when we got inside, I just gave her kind of a sideways hug, and I said, "God bless you." And she almost started crying, and she said, "You can tell a real Christian." And I looked at her, and I smiled, and I said, "Yes, you can." And I bumped into her several times through Hy-Vee, and I thought perhaps I'd end up helping her back to her car, but I don't. Somebody else must have helped her because I didn't see her again. When I got in my car, I cried because I thought, "God, thank you for letting me be." Because she felt, the reason she said, "You can tell a real Christian," is because she felt love. Did I love her in my human? I didn't know this woman, but I felt love come out of me. So I know she felt Jesus. And so I cried when I got in my car because I thought, that's what I'm here for. That's awesome, God. So then I get to work on, or so then I come to church last Sunday. And God's talking to me and telling me all kinds of things, and I'm super excited because I'm going home and I'm putting together another testimony. I promise I won't share that today. And revelation God's given me. And then I go to work on Monday, and I've spoke of this gentleman at work who, I'm not sure what he is. He sometimes posts things on Facebook that lead me to believe, I mean, he believes in Allah and stuff, but yet he talks to me about Christ. And it's such a, I thank God that there's such an environment that it's, we converse and we talk, but it's not like I'm preaching to him. You know, it's just kind of a lighthearted conversation, and I just speak truths every now and then. And if they accept it, great. If they don't, you know, they're not offended because we're just, it's just lighthearted conversation, but I throw nuggets and truth out there wherever I can. And I know he's receiving it because he brings it up all the time. And Monday when I go to work, this other gal who's just fresh out of school, you know, I've been asking God to show me what he sees, right? I see this young girl always has a smile on her face, but I just assume she knows Jesus. Why else do you smile? And she doesn't seem offended at all when we're talking and doing that. But I discovered she doesn't believe in anything. I don't know how that's possible. But she doesn't believe in God. She doesn't believe in Jesus. And so this gentleman says, you know, he's trying to find out, well, what do you believe? But this is how God works. We have a big piece of equipment, and she comes over and she said, look what we found in the equipment today. It's a Bible. There are no torn packages in that equipment. Nothing that they thought, oh, this might have fell out of here. Yeah. Nothing. Wow. And there's a Bible in the bottom. And he says to her, he said, God's trying to talk to you. And I said, and I just verified, yes, he is. Uh-huh. Take it for what you want. But, you know, that wasn't an accident.
Yeah.
And so I was just thinking, you know, God, thank you. That. And then this gentleman wanted to argue about Jesus and God are separate, and that God is almighty, and Jesus was a man, so he couldn't be almighty. And I said, I'm not going to argue with you. I'm just going to tell you, yes, he is. Jesus is God. Mm-hmm. And I just left it at that. Mm-hmm. And he was fine with that, and he still continues to come to me, mm-hmm, asking me things. Mm-hmm. So Tuesday, I go to work, and I'm going in super early so that I can get off extra early because we're dealing with some things with Dan, and I wanted to go with him to the doctor and do all that. And if I were looking at it from the physical perspective, I could be, oh, woe is me, you know, because I got to do this and we're going through that and blah, blah, blah. But I wasn't. I'm looking at it all through God's eyes. And for some reason this week, everything was apparent to me through God's eyes. And so I also learned then on Tuesday that this young man was also raised Jehovah's Witness. And he was talking about confessing your sins. And you know, don't you, he says, Tammy, what do you think? He said, the Bible says you have to confess your sins or, you know, you'll go to hell and that kind of thing. And I just stopped, didn't give it any thought, and I don't know where it came from. I'm assuming it comes from my spirit because that's who I am. And I said, well, I believe there are a lot of people out there that love Jesus or God, but they don't really know him. Mm-hmm. They're walking in the only revelation they have, the only thing they've ever experienced or been taught by their parents or things that they've heard from friends or whatever. But I also believe that if they're sincere and really hungry, God will nudge them into people's lives where they get to hear more of the truth. And because it's the love of God that draws them, right? And so then I told him, and as far as confessing sins, I believe that's kind of what I'm doing today. Not sins, but I think confessing what the world thinks is sins, you know, I drank too much, or I'm struggling with this, or I did that. I think we confess those things to one another so that we know we're not alone. And then you can say something that will encourage me. You can speak a word that will lift me up. I told him the only two sins is whether you believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that he died on the cross and what he did was a finished work, or you don't. I mean, one or the other. You don't believe or you do. Those are the only sins. I said, so if I mess up in an hour and then, you know, I don't have a chance to say, oh God, I'm sorry, and I die, I'm not going to hell. God wants to know whether I believe, and I do. And I share his word, and I try to share the truth when I can. And I just threw that out there. And so then we go to the doctor on Tuesday with Dan, and we went out to the VA. And if anyone has ever dealt with a VA, it's they're not in a hurry to do anything. And they almost make you feel like you're lying. You know, that, I don't know, it was an unusual experience. But at the same time, you could look at all that and think, I'm wasting my time. This is, you know, it is a hassle, and you do have to show a little patience and all of that. But in the waiting room, we end up striking up a conversation with a gentleman who, what? He worked at the Pleasant Hill Post Office for 20 years. I didn't know him personally, but to me, that's God's way of saying, I know where you're at. Because he keeps putting these people in our path that just kind of verify everything. And we just had a nice conversation with him, and he was able to unload. People want somebody to listen to them and feel that you care and that you love. That's what Jesus did. He just reached out and loved people. And so then we saw the doctor, and it didn't go as planned. Long story, even longer. We went and spoke with an advocate at the VA because things weren't getting done, and she made some very good suggestions that we talk with someone else about getting a higher percentage of disability because of the number of things going on, and that we should go talk to Joni Ernst, because even though she can't do anything about the medical situation, the more we bring it to their attention, the more maybe things the government can change and not, you know, get their hands out of things and free the doctors up so that they can actually do what they need to do, kind of thing. And she made all these suggestions, and as we were walking out, and she said, as a matter of fact, there's a gentleman here, instead of having to go to the federal building, she said, there's a gentleman here who you could talk with today. And I said, we're here, let's go talk to him instead of wasting another trip to the federal building. And so as she was walking us there, I just looked at Dan, because I know I'm on the outside looking in. I'm not experiencing the physical things that's going on with him. And I just looked at him, and I tried to speak the word and be encouraging. And I said, you know what? No weapon formed against us can prosper.
Right.
And she heard me. And she said, you're right. You're absolutely right.
Yeah.
Well, two or three agreed.
Wow.
And we just walked around the corner to see this other gentleman. And this other gentleman took some information. And Dan has trouble with hearing. And I've been fighting the system trying to help with that. And nothing's gotten done. And he said two words to him. And he said, you're having trouble hearing me. He said, we're going to do this. And he starts putting stuff in the computer. And he said, I used to be the guy at the other end that reviewed this information. Let me see. How should I word this? So he worded everything from the perspective of somebody that reviews it. So it's going in good hands. And then as he continues to talk, he says, Bondurant, I used to substitute teach at Bondurant. Okay, that's not an accident. And he's also a former Marine. And my husband is a former Marine. And there's something about a brotherhood and family. I mean, it was almost like, I mean, you know, that guy could have been in the Army, or he could have just been a civilian working there. But God placed people in the path to verify that, you know what, you're on the right track. And so things are getting taken care of. So I left there feeling good about that. And then that was Tuesday. So then Wednesday we were supposed to hear back from another doctor, and we waited and we waited. Nothing happened. But it allowed me time to do some reading and stuff like that, and confessing some things. And then Thursday we went back to a doctor. I'm getting my days, they all just ran together, but it was one thing after another. And then what happened on Thursday? Oh, we went down to speak with Joni Ernst. And we couldn't actually speak with her. Obviously, she's a busy woman. We spoke with the gentleman that takes information for her and compiles everything. Again, another Marine. And he'd been to Bondurant. And I mean, it was just really, you know, not a coincidence, because I don't believe in that. And so then on Friday, I took Dan to the VA emergency room, because the medicines that they were barely giving him weren't doing what they were supposed to, and I was concerned that he hadn't slept for like 5 days. So, you know, come on, we got to do something here. And when we did that, we got some answers as to how they're going to proceed and where they're coming from, and not necessarily what we wanted to hear in the physical and in the human perspective. You could think, oh, this is, you know, but I was texting my mom during it, and God just enlightened me and reminded me, because the doctor was talking about, he said, at the end of this, he said, I know it's tough right now, but at the end of this, there's a silver lining, because he was medically speaking about what he foresaw, this is how it should be. But while he was doing that, I was reminded by the Lord of a vision that I had some, 17, 18 years ago, where God healed his knee, not just made it so it didn't hurt anymore, but healed it miraculously. Mm-hmm. And it was a stir in the entire plant at the post office, because everybody knows what his leg looks like and what he's been through and everything. But not only now is it going to cause a stir and a ruckus in the post office, now the VA's involved, and they're gonna, just like with Nathan, they're gonna have all these records that show this, this, and this, and you have this percent of a disability, and it's gonna be gone.
Right.
And so I'm a little bit I understand he's still going through physical things and he's still hurting, and we're trying to get some answers and we're trying to take the edge off. But at the same time, I'm excited because I can really see what God sees. Yes. I see this. Yes. I mean, I just see it. Yes. It's going to happen. And so I'm thanking him for it. And I'm so excited about what God's doing and that he reminded me of that. Because not only did I have the vision, then I dreamed about it a couple times.
Yes.
The stir that it's going to cause at the post office.
Yes.
And then, so I guess what... all these things. Oh, so then we go to the pharmacy to get his prescription, and we're sitting in the waiting area because there's tons of people at the VA.
Mm-hmm.
Who does God put in the seats beside us? Two more Marines. And this gentleman starts talking about how he has PTSD, and they're giving him this medicine for this, and the depression that he went through, and he's just venting and unloading because people are hurting. Everyone has something going on in their life, and everyone is hurting and reaching out.
Mm-hmm.
And what they need is us. They need Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Did I jump up and do anything? Did I lay hands on him suddenly? No, I just sat and listened.
Mm-hmm.
And as we were leaving, we bumped into that gentleman again. He said, "Can I stop you?" "Sure." And he talked a little more, and he said, he looked at my husband, and he said, "I want to tell you." He said, "Her smile, she smiles constantly. You have no idea what that does for someone like me who suffers from PTSD." I started crying because I was just being me and wasn't giving it much thought. I was just trying to comfort the man, make him feel good and let him know that God loved him. And so then I just gave him a big old hug and I said, "God bless you. Thank you for saying that." And he said, "God bless you." And so then we proceed to go pick up the medicine. That gentleman is there again. And he said, "Why don't you sit down here beside me?" He had just had lunch at Brick Street in Bondurant. And he is friends with Brian and Mary Losey, the people that won the million. And he proceeds to share with me his story that he lost his granddaughter when she was 16 years old and what the Loseys had done for him. And I said, "I lost my nephew. And I know the Loseys are a blessing to that community. And God has used them and the money he blessed them with in tremendous ways, in ways many people have no idea what they've done." But yet, he said, "You know," he said, "how are they? Because they've had a struggle with their son. You know, you think they have everything because they have millions." He said, "They got stuff." And I said, "I know. And I think it's getting better, but I don't know personally. But I said, you know, my brothers, they live out by my family." And he said, "Really?" And so, you know, God placed those people in our path to let me know that he knows everything that's going on, to give us a comfort. But at the same time, he allowed me to see through his eyes all week long. So I guess what I wanted to share this morning in a long way is there are people out there hurting. We don't have to, and they either believe or they don't believe. If they don't believe, we don't have to go chasing down those people, and we don't have to say, "You're going to go to hell. You have to believe this and believe that." It's the love of God that draws people. So when the people come up to you, they might just need a smile. They might just need your ear. They might just need a hug. They just might need your presence in their life to draw them to him and the relationship with him, because it's the love of God that draws. Will some people come? Hopefully, yes, that's what we're here for. Will some people not have listened to anything you have to say? I'm sure. But I am so grateful that if we continue to focus on him and try to observe everything we're going through his eyes, it said, "Through all things, give thanks."
Yeah.
Is it tough? Been a rough week watching him go through what he's had to go through. But I give thanks that he's allowed me to see what I saw this week, to feel what I felt this week, to speak what I got to speak this week, and to be him in those people's lives. Will I ever see some of them? Probably won't see any of them ever again. But I guess I just want to encourage everybody, no matter. When Jesus spoke to situations, I'm sure to everybody else around, it looked like hell.
Yeah.
And they probably thought, "What are you talking about?"
Right.
But he saw what God saw.
Right.
And so I just want to encourage everybody to keep looking to him and viewing everything that we're doing through his eyes.
Right.
Because when you do, then you can speak those things and you're not going to second guess yourself, because it's not you, it's him. And that is the reality, not this.
Yes.
Amen. Anyway.
And so it continues. Friday night, we had a tremendously powerful time at the Eastern Gate House of Prayer. And I want to share some of the things that happened. As we were worshiping at the very beginning of the service, we were just doing some just open prophetic worship. And it came out of my mouth that the Lord opened an ancient gate. And I don't even know what that really means, other than something happened. So we had access to something that had been withheld until just this moment. And throughout the service, Psalms 41 was read, Zechariah 4 was read, Psalms 2 was read, Joel 2 was read. And by the end of the service, the Lord was commissioning the generals there were seven men present, and there were just a couple of us ladies. And the Lord commissioned seven generals in the Lord's army. And the Lord, and I'm telling you, since Friday night, it's like, I don't know how to say it other than I feel like a computer and I'm just downloading, I'm downloading, I'm downloading. I see and I hear and I see and I hear and I know. And so this ice storm tried to get all of you to not come today. And I'm glad that you all came, because the Lord wants you to know that you have been commissioned and he has a purpose and a plan. And he showed me that, he told me, we are in the land between the two rivers. A field twice burnt over, but a land where the river of life now flows. And that we are to send out the signal to the others. Like in the old day, I saw that fire signal, right? I know people in the north. I know people in the west. I think that your brother in the east, I think your daughter in the east. I'm to send some. The Lord has a word for the north and the south and the east and the west. So please pray. There's somebody in Texas. I don't know who in Texas. Somebody needs to tell me who in Texas can start the fire. But we are to send out the fire signals to let them know it's time.
Yes.
It's time that he is gathering his people. And just like in the days of old where they would light the fires in the mountaintops and it just went, the Lord showed me he is striking a fire across this nation for his glory and for his kingdom.
Thank you, Lord.
And he told me the generals that were commissioned, the Joshuas, the Davids, the Gideons, these generals have the power to lead God's people in utter victory. And I am talking total annihilation of the kingdom of darkness.
Yes,
complete
glory.
And total victory.
Come on.
And as I've prayed, and as the generals were up here praying for our pastor, I was just moved and I hit my knees, and the Lord told me that he was handing out the mantle of Deborah. And Alvin didn't even know, but he came over to me after the Lord said that and he said, "Rise as a queen." And so there is a mantle for the Deborahs, those who have the generals, those who have the prophetic vision to give wisdom to the generals as they do battle. And the Lord told me that he has a special blessing. There's three mantles for the men of this body, and there's three mantles for the women of this body. The generals have been commissioned, the fathers. There are those of you, and I believe Don and I believe Nathan, your fathers. You are given the blessing of Abraham. There is a promise that the Lord has given you that has not come to pass. And he's given you a Sarah by your side who has been faithful and who is the one who will birth the dreams, that the promises. They are the ones that are going to birth the promises, but it is now coming to pass. And when, okay, Sarahs, when your Abraham tells you these promises, you're going to want to laugh. But the Lord says, now, I do it now in Jesus' name. And lastly, there's a blessing for the shepherds. And the blessing of the shepherds is the blessing of Paul. The blessing of Paul is coming upon those who are going to gather and lead and nourish the flock. And there are so many of those needed. And for the women, the gift of Deborah, the mantle of Deborah, I believe that there are those who are going to see insights into battle, who are going to see as the Lord sees, who are going to see the plots of the enemy before they even come to pass.
Yes.
And the Esthers, there's going to be a great amount of influence in our women to influence the situations and to have favor in very touchy situations. And lastly, the mantle of Mary for extravagant worship. There are going to be women breaking open their box in worship, and there's going to be a fragrance, and there's going to be a favor and a oneness, because Mary caught the Lord's eye, and he knew her, and he and they were one. And so there is an extravagant worship. And it's not one, it can be all.
Yes.
But I want everybody to pray about your place, because now is the time for us to take our place, because the Lord is saying, this is just for us right here. There's other mantles being sent to the north. There's other mantles being sent to the south and the east. But this is our job.
Yes.
This is our job right now. And he's calling us together to walk in victory and to watch as the kingdom of darkness is destroyed in Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Utter annihilation is what he told me.
Yes.
So I want you to expect the enemy to be defeated with utter annihilation to the point where there's not even the dust left.
Yes.
I'm telling you, there's so much, like so much. The Lord says open and search, and oh man, he wants to tell us. I'm telling you guys, I can't stop. Like, I can barely drive my car alone because I'm hearing and I'm seeing. So please take a pen to paper. Write it down. Search the word. Find who you are and find your callings and take it up.
Yes.
Now is the time.
Yes.
Now is the time.
Yes.
Anybody else have anything to share this morning? Yeah, Roberto.
Great outcome.
know if you guys follow a lot of the prophetic voices around the nation, but there's been a lot of talk about it being the nameless revival. Well, I don't even think it's going to be a revival. It's going to be an illumination. That's what the Lord told me. Don't pray for a revival. Pray for illumination, because it, when the Lord lights it up, when we all partake and we all shine our light, it's an illumination that utterly annihilates. It's an illumination that annihilates the kingdom of darkness. And that's what's going to happen, is an illumination. And that's going to, in the light, he is known. He is the light.
Yes.
Amen.
Yeah, amen. Amen. Anyone else? Yeah, Mike.
Continue to pray for Cindy. I take her into the dentist / oral surgeon tomorrow to finish up what should have been done before I left in North Carolina. She's still in pain. There's still some bone that's apparently pressing against the nerve in her mouth, and it's causing a lot of pain right now. Her breathing is doing okay, but it's actually, with all the medication and stuff, is trying to affect her and her system. It's just blatant warfare is what it is. We understand what it is, and we're standing and believing for total healing and restoration for her right now. And for Sheila.
Yes.
John, what's the latest?
Yeah, appreciate your prayers. Sheila, she took a bad fall and messed her leg and knee up, and she's facing some surgery here in a few days. Hopefully they can go in there and straighten things up. And she's got a torn probably ligament, meniscus, hamstring, just really messed it up. So just lift her up in prayer that God will be with them. Thing, which he always is, and the more we pray, the more he's there, you know. So just appreciate this church and you, my brothers and sisters, that we're getting through it together. And like you say, we're just going on to much greater things. We got all these setbacks and things that come against us, but it's all for a better victory and more glory to God. Just pray in his holy name.
Amen.
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 I just feel like the Lord's revealing to my spirit that right now is what I shared last Sunday about one accord, being in one accord. And when they were, the power went out.
Yes.
And the disciples were in one mind and one accord. And Tammy shared with me last Sunday is we really are already because we have Jesus in us.
Mm-hmm.
We've all gone through things through the week, and I just feel like God is saying, to lay it down right now. Lay it down as we are corporately gathered together. And his spirit will pour out in this room. It's in us. It's already here.
Yes.
It's not like we're waiting for anything. It's already here. And I just feel like if somebody needs a healing delivered, it's now. It's right now. It's in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus. Amen.
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 Yes.
Sorry, because I said enough already. But
right.
Like she said, the reason I said that is because they were waiting for the Spirit to be poured out. We are in one mind. It's the mind of Christ.
Yes.
So we don't have to sit here and wait for something to happen or to beg for something to happen. The fact that we've gathered together, we are.
Yes.
We all have the mind of Christ. So we are in one mind and in one accord. And when I said that there's a hurting world out there, they're not just hurting spiritually, which is to me the most important because we want them to spend eternity with Christ, but they're hurting physically. And if you look around here, the things we've been going through, the pain, the breathing, the cancer,
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Come, Lord. Let us loose the rivers of living water that are within us, Lord. Lord, those who have a need, Lord, let them lay it at your feet, Lord. Let it be finished this morning, Lord. For the physical needs, Lord. For the mental needs, Lord. For the spiritual needs. For the financial needs. For the relational needs, Lord. Let it be finished. Jesus, we look to you, Lord. Holy Spirit, come. We gather together in one mind, one accord, Lord. Looking to you, Lord, to lead us and guide us, Lord, in victory, Lord. Let it be unto us according to your word, Lord. Let it be unto us according to your word, the spoken word, the rhema word, Lord, the written word, Lord. Give us wisdom and revelation like never before as you unlock the hidden mysteries in your word. Those who have an ear to hear, let them hear the truth, and they shall be set free. Those who have eyes to see, let them see the goodness of knowing you, Lord. And this morning, love, we come to taste of your goodness. We come expecting for you to show up and do what you do, Lord. You're going to heal where there's a healing needed, Lord. You're going to restore where there's weariness, Lord. You're going to provide where there's lack, Lord. That you're going to open the doors that have been shut, Lord. That you're going to do what only you can do when we put our hope and our trust in you, Lord. That you are good. That you are faithful, Lord. And that your works are yes and amen, Lord. Who need to be told what their position, what their calling is, Lord. Lead them through the word to show them who they are. As you raise them up in power, as you raise them up in the knowledge of who they are and your purpose and your plans. That you have commissioned your people to come and follow after you, Lord. To walk in victory, to walk, to heal those around us just by our shadows, just by our smiles, just by our hugs. That one hug changes the eternal destiny of a man or a woman, Lord. Let your love flow. Let your grace flow. And as we open to you, Lord, we open ourselves, Lord, and say, live through us, Jesus. Have your way. Let the river of life flow. Through this city, through this state, and through this nation, Lord. That you are raising up a people who will be bold to speak truth. Who will be bold to love like never before. Who will give of themselves just as you gave, Lord. Holding nothing back and believing that when we pray, it is finished. That we, when we lay hands on the sick, that they recover. Lord, as we worship, fingers are going to grow back. Mike's going to regain a thumb, Lord. And as we worship, as we pray, those who have a physical need will leave here, forgetting they even had a malady, forgetting they even had a situation.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, I pray for the marriages. I pray for the lost children. I pray for the generations to come, Lord. You make all things new. You make all things new. Come in newness of life, Lord. Come in power. Have your way in this service today, Lord. We are expecting. And we are looking. When those doors open, we will walk through. As you lead us and guide us by your Holy Spirit into all and utter victory. That you receive all of the glory. In Jesus. It's no longer we who live, but you, Christ, who lives in us. It is an army of one. An army of one. Jesus. And you will be lifted high, Lord, and you will receive all the praise and all the glory. Oh, we thank you, Lord, that you have called us, that you have chosen us and plucked us out and called us by name, that you know every hair on our head, that you have created us, and that you make perfection. You have made us perfect. You have made us whole. And you have called us righteous. In Jesus' name. Have your way this morning, Lord. Let us loose our tongues and speak freely as you speak to our hearts and our minds, Lord. And give our feet boldness to walk and move and pray for those needs that are here today, Lord. Let not one leave today with a lack or a need. Not one, Lord. Yes, Lord. We say yes. Our spirits and our hearts and our minds, we say yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. All things are possible with you, Lord. And we thank you that you are the God of the impossible. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Yes. Is anybody else's spirit just screaming yes? Yes. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Whatever you have, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. More. So much more. Yes, Lord. Have your way this morning. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. I am a believer. Signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Of this body functions to the perfection to which God created to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Toby and Don, you two want to come take the offering this morning? Don and Toby? Yes, Don and Toby. You want to pray this morning, Don? There you go. The yes of us, please.
Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to be here today, Lord. It is so important that we assemble ourselves together. Because we never know when we're at the mountaintop, somebody's in the valley. And it's absolutely essential to lift one another up. We just praise your holy name, and we know, Father, that you gave us this promise. If it were possible, the very elect would be deceived, meaning it is not possible. So we stand against the powers yes. of darkness,
yes.
knowing sometimes all we feel is just your presence.
Yes.
We don't always feel victory, but we know that victory is there.
Yes.
By faith yes. we stand. By your word
yes.
we stand.
Yes, Lord.
Yes.
When we can feel nothing else, see nothing
yes,
else, we stand.
have to go through them because you went through them.
Jesus, Lord.
But you will go with us.
Yes, Lord.
Bless the suffering, bless the service. Give us a great time in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Praise God. Let's lift our hands and love the Lord this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Lord, we bless you today. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for everything you've done in this service already. Thank you for what you're doing in the lives of your people. Here, at home, on the job, wherever we may be, Lord, we thank you that you never leave us or forsake us. Always desiring to be manifest through your people. We give you thanks and praise for that great privilege, Lord, for your goodness and your grace and your love for all of humanity. We bless you this morning, Lord. You alone are worthy of all praise and all worship. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Amen. God bless you all. You may be seated. Praise God. Thank you, Tammy. Thank you, Suzanne. Thank you, Mike and worship team. Thank all of you for sharing words of encouragement and prayer requests. And amen. All that's gone forth this morning. Praise God. Hallelujah. God is good. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let the Sunday school young ones can go. I'd like to just try to go a little bit further with everything that's already been said, and the way that the Spirit is moving, and I feel like that's the word that I have for you this morning. And I'd like to start at Hebrews 11, and I want to read verses 1 through 6. I know we read these all the time and we talk about faith, but I'd like to just make it a little bit simpler maybe and a little more touchable for humans, amen? We're spirits, but we still live in this body and have to function in a world. And sometimes I think we get confused with the... You see, I guess what I'm trying to say is we're spirits whether we like it or not. And we live a spiritual life because we are born again, because we have the Spirit of God living in us. We have spirit life. That's what drives us. That's what motivates us and moves us. So it isn't like we really have to try to do things. If we would just relax and be what we really are, it happens naturally. And I think that's what Tammy and Suzanne both are talking about. You know, when words come out of our mouth, it's like Jesus said, we have the Spirit of Christ in us. We have the mind of Christ. So our words have spirit and they have life. We just need to recognize that so that when we speak with that authority. Not in a way of demeaning people or to put people down or to overpower them or anything, but just simply to release our words with the power that they actually have, knowing what God really wants to do and what God wants to say. And sometimes I think we can, I don't think you can over-spiritualize it, but we can over-humanize it, spiritually speaking, and try to, you know, get funky and freaky, and we end up losing our real credibility when it comes to the unsaved. And you know, when we talk about the prophetic and that, it's all true. I mean, there is not one word that isn't true. This whole thing is prophetic. We are prophetic by nature. We have the Spirit of prophecy living in us. Christ is the Spirit of prophecy.
Yes.
We just need to realize that and just speak it. You know, just let it go. Just let it happen and watch what God does then as a result of that. Amen. I mean, we get religious, and I read something here a while back, and it, you know, incompetence, when we think about incompetence, and I think of it in religious terms, trying to do stuff religiously and make something happen spiritually. And it's like incompetence. When you when you really believe that you can make up for a lack of skill by doubling your efforts. There's no end to what you can't do. Praise the Lord. I mean, and we've tried this, and we've learned that it doesn't work. I mean, it just doesn't. And no matter how much you want to put lipstick on a pig, it's still the pig, you know. And so it's, I think what the Holy Spirit is really trying to do, and is what he's saying through these women that spoke this morning and different ones that have spoken throughout the last several weeks and months, for that matter, that's God is just trying to simplify this thing. Just bring it back down to the way Jesus operated. He wasn't religious. I mean, that's why he got so much grief. He was just trying to give people a relationship that could change their lives and change everything. When God said, peace on earth, that's shalom. That means he wants everything restored, everything made whole for each and every one of us. And that's the priority, and it should be our priority, not only for ourselves and our immediate loved ones, but for anybody and everybody that God places in our path to have influence over. So let's begin here at Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. By faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by he being dead yet speaketh. By faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found, because God had translated him. For before his translation he had this testimony, that he pleased God. But without faith it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So I want you to think about what Abel did. Now, one translation says he offered a better sacrifice. His sacrifice, if you know the chronology of this, his sacrifice became before the law existed. There was no law. So it wasn't a sacrifice of repentance, and it couldn't have been a sacrifice of atonement, and it wasn't a sin offering or anything of that nature, because none of those things even existed in the minds of humans. God hadn't made any demands for it. There wasn't any motivation for it. So it was simply an unsolicited, authentic act of worship, which is what we've experienced this morning. That's a sacrifice, whether you understand it as that or not. That's what it is. It's called the sacrifice of praise. So, because a lot of times we come in and we don't feel like it. You know what I mean? And even when we're doing it, our minds are wandering to other things. But it's still a sacrifice. God receives it as a sacrifice because he knows us. Praise the Lord. So it was an unsolicited, authentic act of worship. And the Greek word for that translation, because there isn't that translation that says a better sacrifice. And the Greek translation there for better is pleon, pleion, and it means more. So the better translation would be that Abel offered a more sacrifice. Qualitative speaking, he was talking about he gave more. Now, King James, is what we read here this morning, says a more excellent sacrifice. But when you read it in the original Greek, and I have a Greek and Hebrew parallel Bible that gives you the literal word-for-word translation that as it came from the scrolls, and it says, the adjective excellent isn't there. It just doesn't exist in the original writing. The only adjective used is, again, pleon, which means a more sacrifice. So Abel gave a more sacrifice. Abel's sacrifice was an act of faith, and God declared him righteous because of it.
Amen.
Amen? If you could back up to that verse 4, I think it is. By faith Abel offered unto God a more sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained a witness that he was righteous. Why? Because his offering was one of faith. Okay? Praise the Lord. So look at Mark chapter 12, verse 42 and 43. Our sacrifice, our offerings, our worship, God sees as faith. That's why we're called righteous. Because by faith we worship something we've never seen,
right.
Something that we can only believe by faith.
Right.
Yeah. And because we worship that way, God sees it as a more sacrifice. More than a religious ritual, more than all the other things you can do, he doesn't see that as anything other than human action. But when we worship God, he sees it as a more sacrifice, okay? And so there came this poor widow woman. You remember the story. All the people were going through. Some of them were throwing in big bills. You know, some of them were doing this, you know, wanting the praise of people. Like, look what, how much. I give way more than that and all this stuff. So here comes this certain poor widow, and she threw in two mites, which make a farthing, which is little or nothing, basically. And he called unto him his disciples, and he said unto them, Verily I say unto you, that this poor widow hath cast more in than all they which have cast into the treasury. In other words, her offering was greater than everybody else.
Yes.
Now, that's the same Greek adjective as in Hebrews 11:4.
Mm.
Pleon. She gave a more sacrifice, a more offering. Even though it was less than everybody else's, quantitatively, qualitatively, it was more than everybody else's.
Yes.
And that's what Jesus is pointing out. Why did Jesus call it the more sacrifice? Because it required faith.
Yeah.
Because it was all she had.
Yeah.
She was trusting that what she gave God would then bless her. It was an act of faith.
Yes.
Right. Romans 12, verse 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now we're talking about the ultimate sacrifice, ultimate faith, trusting God with your everything.
Yes.
It's what Tammy's talking about. It's what Suzanne's talking about, maybe using different verbiage, but we're saying the same thing. It's about just depending on God, that he's going to bring about what God has promised that he will bring about.
Yes.
God sees that as an offering of faith.
Right.
And he can't help but want to bless it.
Right.
That's what declares us to be righteous or acceptable in the sight of God.
Yes.
It's not complicated.
No.
Religion is complicated. This relationship is not complicated at all. It's just a relationship of trust. Of putting our faith in God and believing what God says is going to happen. No matter what everything else says, what he says. Everything told this woman, if I get these last two pennies, it's like the woman who was going to give that last loaf of bread, to, you know, or bite of bread or whatever. If I get this, it's over. I'm dead.
Right.
It's like suicide. But she says, I'm going to trust that God is good, that God will provide my needs according to his riches and glory. All of those things, that God will heal my body. I'm going to do this. I'm going to give.
Yes.
Because I believe,
right,
God to be faithful.
Right.
God can't help but honor that.
Exactly.
He says, he looks at that, he sees that person, and he says, there's a righteous person.
Uh-huh.
That person is righteous.
Yes. Yeah.
Hebrews 11, again, verses 5 and 6. By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God. This is interesting. He pleased God. And then the very next thing, Paul explains this, and he says, but without faith, it's impossible to please God. So how did Enoch please God? Simply by faith.
Amen.
By putting his faith in God.
Amen.
He believed God. And God counted that as righteousness, but without faith it's impossible to please him, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is.
Yeah.
And that he's a rewarder then of them who diligently seek him.
Yes.
So without faith, it's impossible to please God. Enoch had faith, and it pleased God.
Yeah.
God was pleased with Enoch. Not because Enoch was better than other people, not because Enoch was necessarily the most sinless person or fewer sins or whatever it might, we might imagine, but simply because he believed God.
Yeah.
So let's go back to Genesis and look at this again. Genesis chapter 5, verses 21 through 24. And that's where this Paul is actually preaching from. And Enoch lived 65 years and begat Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God after he begat Methuselah 300 years and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. So there isn't a whole lot more information here than there is in Hebrews. But there is something powerful. The statement that Enoch walked with God.
Yes.
Says it twice in that little portion of Scripture. So it's got to be worth paying attention to. Mm-hmm. If God repeats something, he's trying to get our attention. He's trying to get us to look and
right.
see what it is he's talking
right.
about. So Abel shows us where life the life of faith, where our faith begins. But Enoch shows us what life and faith are all about. He shows us what the life of faith consists of.
Yes.
So Enoch walked with God.
Yes.
And that's about all we know. So think about this. I just mentioned this in passing Wednesday night because it was on my mind and I was already trying to put a few things together. I wasn't preaching, I was just sitting there with something that was brought up. But when you think about walking, you think of, first of all, it has to be a voluntary act. You got to choose to walk, right?
Yeah.
So it's a voluntary act. Enoch walked with God. It doesn't say God dragged Enoch, you know, he twisted his arm and forced him. It says Enoch walked with God. And walking also then infers progress. I mean, we don't generally walk backwards. So when we think of walking, you're thinking of moving forward.
Right.
So it's a voluntary act that moves you forward.
Right.
Walking also requires intimacy. If you're walking with, I'm not just talking about, you know, taking a personal private stroll down, you know, through the woods, but he says he walked with God. So walking with immediately implies intimacy. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
And it also facilitates intimacy. You ever walk with somebody?
Yeah.
It implies that you're intimate with that person or close to that person, but it also facilitates that reality because the more you walk with them, the more you get to know each other, the more you talk, the more comfortable you become with each other, right?
Yes.
So that's all that is happening here. And so intimacy is really the issue here. Walking with God denotes an ongoing relationship and intimacy. Noah, it says, walked with God.
Yes.
Abraham walked with God. Isaac walked with God. It's a metaphor for a relationship with God.
Yes.
So let's look at Amos chapter 3, verse 3. Can two walk together except they be agreed? What do we talk about all the time? We have to agree with what God says if we're going to get what God wants us to have. We can't be, you know, confessing everything that the world says and the doctor and the lawyers and the Indian chiefs and everybody else. We've got to confess what God says. We have to be in agreement with God. You can't walk with God. Remember, this is a metaphor for intimacy. We're not just talking about God meet me through the world. I'm walking with God means I'm intimate with God. I cannot be intimate with God unless I can agree with God. If I don't agree with God, I'm not going to walk very far with God.
Exactly.
You don't walk with somebody you're fussing and arguing with very long.
Right.
One of you is going to split and go the other direction just to get away from each other, right? So if you walk with somebody, you'd have to agree on some things, right?
Amen.
Just, I mean, in the natural. You'd have to agree on where you're going.
Right?
Right? If you're going to Walmart and I'm going to Target, we're not going to walk very far together before
right.
we're going to have to split off.
Right.
So just by nature, by definition, walking with somebody means you have to have some things that you're in agreement about, and one of those things is where you're going.
Right.
The other thing would be the path that you're going to take.
Right.
And also the pace that you walk that walk. Sally's always getting on me because I forget things, and I just, you know, she's shopping and I'm on a mission. So I'm not thinking, I'm just walking, and she's, slow down. I'm thinking, speed up, come on, let's get this over with. You know, this isn't fun. This is a job we got to do, you know. So, but I'm saying, in the spirit, it's the same way. We have to be at the same pace. We have to have a destination that we know we're headed for. We have to be in agreement about that destination. We have to be agreed on the path that we're going to take to that destination. And then we have to agree about the rate of which we're going to pass through this walk, or the pace that we're going to set. Because it's easy to get ahead of God, and it's easy to drag your feet, and God's having to, you know, prod you along all the time. And that's not what God wants. And actually, God won't do that.
Right.
So the goal, really, of Christianity is for us to walk with Jesus.
Yep.
Because Christianity is a religion.
Right.
But Jesus is a person.
And
the relationship is not with the religion, the relationship is with Jesus. So we want to walk with Jesus. We want to have this intimacy, this relationship with Jesus. So it's really all about walking with him, or intimacy with him.
Right.
And you know what the most important thing to God is? His glory.
Yes.
Amen.
Come on.
Now God can say that and not be selfish or, you know, egotistical or any of that stuff, because he's perfect. He's God.
Yep.
So if it was about my glory, that would seem really idiotic and you know, self-conscious and all that kind of stuff. But with God, it's perfectly sound reasoning that God thinks that his glory is the most important thing.
Mm-hmm.
So let's look at Psalms chapter 57, verse 5. Just as an example, of course, we all know that the Bible is filled with this, that God won't share his glory with anybody, and it's all about his glory, right? So be thou exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let thy glory be above all the earth. Another place in Isaiah talks about, and his glory fills the earth the way the waters cover the sea. And remember when Jesus was born and the angels came and they said, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, shalom to all mankind. That's the key. Without God being glorified, we don't get shalom. We don't get fulfilled. We don't get the fullness of what God intended us to be. To be whole, to be healed, to be prospered, to be blessed, to be a blessing. So Jesus said, thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. How many of you know God is glorified in heaven?
Amen.
Just read it. It's the angel said it.
Yep.
Amen. In order for that reality to be here on earth, Jesus said, we have to pray, your kingdom come.
Right.
Yes.
Your glory be manifest here.
Yes.
So that we can experience shalom.
Yes.
So that we can actually have what it is you want to give us. Right?
Right.
So look at 2 Thessalonians now, chapter 1. And I want to read verses 3 through 12, Mike. 2 Thessalonians 1, verses 3 through 12. We are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is meet, because that your faith groweth exceedingly, and the charity of every one of you, or the love of every one of you, toward each other aboundeth, so that we ourselves glory in you in the churches of God for your patience and faith in all of your persecutions and tribulations that you endure. This is exactly what Tammy was talking about this morning, almost word for word, if she used King James language, right? Which is a manifest token of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which ye also suffer. Seeing it is a righteous thing that God, with God, to recompense tribulation to them that trouble you. And to you who are troubled, rest with us, when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power, when he shall come to be glorified in his saints, to be admired in all them that believe, because our testimony among you was believed in that day. Wherefore also we pray always for you that our God would count you worthy of this calling and fulfill all the good pleasure of his goodness, his shalom, and the work of faith with power. That the name of our Lord Jesus Christ may be glorified in you and ye in him according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. So to glorify God, we have to be kingdom builders. Amen. We have to be building and seeking first his kingdom.
Yes.
Which again is exactly what has been spoken this morning.
Yes.
So we have to agree with God on where we're going.
Yes.
We have to agree with God what the end goal is for his glory.
Yeah.
Yes.
Not my ministry. Not a big church. Those things can happen, but if they happen, it'll happen out of the context of what God's wanting to do to show his glory. Not our personal aggrandizement, no matter who we are, what we are, but simply because God wants to be glorified.
Yes.
And as long as we walk with God,
yes,
it happens.
Yes.
It happens automatically. That's what Paul's telling us here.
Yes.
We just love each other.
Yes.
We love others.
Yes.
We trust God. And God's glory is revealed.
Yes. Yes.
Hebrews chapter 11, again, verse 5. So Enoch, by faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death and was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God. And we know the only way he could please God was by faith, right? He walked with God. So he had this testimony. He was translated so that he wouldn't see death. Nobody found him because God had translated him. Now, translated. Again, let me give you another big Greek word. I don't speak Greek, so, you know, I'm just saying this because I figure you don't either, and you won't know if I'm pronouncing it right or not. But it's, I can spell it for you, but I'll just try to say it. It's metatithemi, metatithemi. And it means, that's the Greek word here for translated. And it means change from one place to another, which is obvious, right?
Right.
And that happens at the rapture. And we know that's one context that Paul's talking about, but it's not the only context, because there's always deeper things that God's saying. May there be something on the surface that's absolutely true, but the more you look, the deeper it goes, and the more you realize there's other things here that God's trying to tell us. Amen? So it's the rapture, but translation also happens when we are changed from to. Okay? Look at Colossians chapter 1, 9 through 14. Colossians 1, verses 9 through 14. Stuttering in my mind. So for this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long-suffering with joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. So, we're talking about translation, and just like the Galatians, we need to think of ourselves as having made a change of address.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
So I was talking about that at the very beginning. Yes, we're human beings, but that's not who we're spirit beings, whether we know it, like it, or want to admit it, or don't, or do, it doesn't matter.
Right.
We are. That's That's who and what we are. Amen. We've had a change of address. We're no longer flesh. We are spirit in the eyes of God. Yes, we still have flesh, but God doesn't deal with us that way. He deals with us by the Spirit. That's what got born again. That's what makes us like Him. That is what makes it possible for us to have intimacy with Him,
yes,
to walk with Him.
Yes.
We're not lumbering around, you know, stumbling and bumbling and carrying on in the flesh. We're in the Spirit. We have intimacy with God, and that's the metaphor, was to walk with God,
yes,
just so that we could understand it in human terms, right?
Right.
So, we've been delivered. We have a change of address from darkness to the kingdom of His dear Son.
Yes. Yes.
We've been delivered from the kingdom of darkness that rules this world,
mm-hmm,
that dominates it, that directs it, and defines it,
mm-hmm,
into the kingdom of Jesus Christ, who is the ruler of the entire universe, where all truth lies.
Mm-hmm.
Not facts, but truth. You are healed. You're whole. You're prospered. You're delivered. You are righteous.
Yes.
Amen. Hebrews again, back to Hebrews 11:5, one more time. This is where Enoch, by faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found because God had translated him. For before he was his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God. So he did not see death, right?
Right.
We have been given eternal life. God life.
Yeah.
We're not going to ever die.
Right.
This life.
Right.
But we are never going to die.
Right.
We've been translated from the kingdom of darkness,
yes,
into the kingdom of His dear Son.
Right.
We have God life. We have eternal life. We will not die.
Right.
We will not see death.
That's right.
Thank you, God.
Thank you,
Lord. We've been given this eternal life. It's the life that is lived by the power of the Holy Spirit in Christ. Resurrection power, that's what He tells us. He was raised up by the Spirit. We have that same Spirit, that same resurrection Spirit living in us. We cannot die. We have new life. We have God life. We have been translated from the kingdom of darkness. Woo, that I'm telling you, we've been translated from the natural to the supernatural. We've been translated from a finite life to an infinite life.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Why? Because we walk with God, and then we are not.
Right.
They may have a funeral for me. I don't know if anybody will be around then, you know, if we all get raptured first, but I'm just saying, don't be weeping about me, because I won't be here. I'll be walking with God. I will just not be here anymore. I was here, and then I'm not.
Amen.
Because I had this testimony.
Yes.
I believe God.
Yes.
And God translated me.
Right.
The good news for us is we already been translated. Enoch had to have it happen right then and there. We've already had the translation take place.
Yes.
Amen. We've already been translated into the kingdom of His dear Son, into the kingdom of light from the kingdom of darkness.
Right.
Amen. So our life goes on forever.
Right. Yes.
Because we walk with God.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Second Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17. I'm talking about faith, you know. I'm talking about what makes this happen.
Yeah.
It brings glory to God. It glorifies God. That is His highest priority. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Jesus said, I make all things new. I translate people.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I've been doing it since Enoch.
Right.
Praise God.
Yes.
So we have a new plan, new power,
mm-hmm,
and a new place.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
The glory of God is the power of God. And the kingdom of God,
yeah,
is our place.
Yes.
Yes.
Walking with God means we stay on the path of God. We stay in agreement with God.
Sure, right.
In spite of what,
sure,
the kingdom of darkness tries to sell us.
Exactly.
Look at Isaiah chapter 30, verse 21. And you see kind of some fulfillments here, but Isaiah 30, verse 21. Mine ears shall hear a word behind thee saying. This again is what Tammy was talking about in just different verbiage. A word behind thee saying, this is the way. Walk ye in it. Why? Because there's witnesses here. There's stuff that's showing you. It's not an audible voice, but it's a voice that says, this is okay. This is right. Yeah. So this is a word behind thee saying, this is the way. Walk ye in it. When you turn to the right hand and when you turn to the left. Now look at Romans chapter 8 and verse 14. This is the Spirit. This is walking with God. This is being led by the Spirit.
Right.
For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God.
Right.
Yes.
Think the devil doesn't know that?
Right.
All right, 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. This then is the message we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all.
Yes.
Amen.
We've been translated into the kingdom of his dear son, into the kingdom of light. So God, in God, there's no darkness at all. He's pure light.
Yes.
Right.
Pure revelation. There's no lies in God. There's no deception. There's no falseness like the devil tries to bring darkness and lies and deceit to us. In God, it's pure truth. It's pure revelation. It's pure light. Look at Ephesians now, chapter 5 and verse 8. For you sometimes, were sometimes darkness, but now ye are the light in the Lord. So walk as children of light. What does that mean? Don't walk in that deception anymore. Walk in the truth.
Yes.
Walk with God.
Yes.
Stay intimate with God. Stay on the same path with God. Have the same destination with God. Keep the same pace with God. You're not dark anymore. You're not in the darkness.
No.
You're not in deception.
Right.
So you got to walk in the light, because unless you walk in the light, the people in darkness won't see light.
Right.
They just see more darkness, and that's why they're confused. Without light, you think it's supposed to be dark, right?
Right.
Yes. Praise the Lord. All right, God is love. Walk in love. You know, that's what the scripture tells us. I could give you all the scriptures for it, but I'm not going to do it for the sake of time. God is truth. Walk in truth, it tells us.
Amen.
Don't walk in the lies of the enemy. He tells us, walk in truth. You're free. You're healed. You're prospered. You're empowered. You are the righteousness of God. Walk in that reality, and don't let the devil suck you or try to draw you back into darkness.
Right.
If you're walking with God, it can't happen. Because you got the same destination.
Right.
Amen. You're in agreement.
Yes.
Yep.
Got the same pace. You're headed in the right direction.
Right.
All right, we'll finish with this scripture. Galatians chapter 5, verse 25. If we live in the Spirit,
yeah.
I just love it. I love how the Holy Spirit works.
Yeah.
It all works together. When it's the truth, it all fits. You can just grab scriptures anywhere, and I guarantee you they'd fit.
Right.
Because it's God.
It's God.
And when it's God, he makes it fit.
Yes.
So that we understand.
Yep.
If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. In other words, all the way back to what we were talking about at the very beginning, we're spirits.
Yes.
Walk in the Spirit. It's not hard.
Exactly.
It's natural for us to do it. To walk with God, you need to agree with God.
Amen.
The place, the path, and the pace.
Yes.
When we do that, God is glorified.
Yes.
And Jesus' prayer is answered.
Amen.
His kingdom comes.
Yes.
He's glorified throughout the world.
Yes,
yes.
As the water covers the sea.
Yes.
And we have shalom.
Yes.
Peace on earth.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate your patience this morning. Thanks, everybody, for sharing. Be careful going home. I think we're cool with the weather until late tonight. So get where you're going and
yes.
Hunker down and enjoy a quiet night off the ice.
Yeah.
Only hockey players should be out there tonight. Praise the Lord.
Yes.